Well, hello again, Golden Eagles. I'm Jim Call, Chief Communication Officer. And today, I'm at the University of Mississippi Medical Center, a place with a long and storied history of innovation. And part of that innovation today is being led by Dr. Chris Anderson, a Southern Miss alumnus. Now, you may have seen Dr. Anderson in the news recently. In December, he and his team performed a successful simultaneous heart and liver transplant on an Alabama man. So we're going to ask him about that success and some of his other successes, as well as his time at Southern Miss and all the things that contributed to his career today. I hope you enjoyed today's Southern Miss story. Well, thank you, Dr. Anderson, for taking the time to talk with us today.
It's my pleasure. I'm happy to do it.
Sure. So for people that don't know who you are or what you do, tell us a little bit about yourself.
Well, I identify myself as a transplant surgeon. I am currently the chair of the Department of Surgery at University of Mississippi Medical Center and the chief of transplant here. I came here about 7.5 years ago, recruited to really rebuild the transplant program, start the liver transplant program, start a pancreas transplant program, and sort of be sure that we're maximizing that access to care for Mississippi.
So you said you were recruited here to rebuild mm-hmm. the transplant program. The transplant program has a long and storied history. Tell us a little bit about that.
It does. So the transplant program here is very unique, and it really started with Dr. James Hardy, who was the founding chair of surgery here. As academic medical centers go, this one's actually relatively young, started in 1955. He was recruited to start the Department of Surgery. He had a very keen interest in organ transplantation and had a robust laboratory effort and really proved the concept of much of organ transplantation in the lab. And then in 1963, here at this institution, performed the world's first lung transplant. He followed that up in 1964 with the world's first heart transplant.
So in December, you led a team that performed a simultaneous heart and liver transplant. Tell us a little bit about that.
There's not a whole lot of centers that'll take that on. Somebody told me it was about 14. So it's not necessarily a new thing, but it's certainly a new thing here. And it's a proof in concept of where our center stands today compared to many years ago. We have built the infrastructure, built the teams, and transplant is a team sport, built the teams and the care pathways and the workflows that allow us to take on these complex cases and have success with them. In that patient's instance, the patient had liver disease but also had heart failure, and the heart failure was actually driving the liver disease. There is a phenomenon called cardiac cirrhosis where you can develop cirrhosis just secondary to chronic heart failure. And so that patient was not going to be able to withstand a liver transplant alone or a heart transplant alone. And so you either had to do both organs or do nothing. And that patient has done great. I think there's a good sense of pride in our team that we were able to do that here, and it shows how far we've come. Some of the other things that we have done that maybe aren't unique in the transplant community but are pretty rare and certainly first time here would be things like splitting a deceased donor liver between two adults. And it's important that it's between two adults because it's not all that uncommon to split a liver and take a smaller piece for a child and a larger piece for an adult. But in this instance, what we've done is we've basically divided the liver anatomically in half and transplanted two adults with one donor. So to date, we've done that three times. So three deceased donor organs have successfully transplanted six people with chronic liver failure and cirrhosis. And they're all doing great, and it's just one of the little things that you have to do, I feel that you have to do to be responsible in organ transplant, because we don't have enough organs. We have to maximize what we have. And really, one of the only ways we're going to grow liver transplant nationally is to do things like this, that on the surface may seem a little risky, but if you do the true risk-benefit analysis, there's no question that the patient's benefiting in the long run from taking these efforts.
So what's it like as a physician that performs something like that, or a surgeon that performs something like that, and then you see someone go on to live a life that's obviously much better than the one that they had when they walked in your door?
In the vast majority of cases, being a transplant surgeon is a very rewarding field. It's instant gratification. You know, patients, kidney transplants, usually come in on dialysis. The comment I get over and over is, I didn't realize how bad I felt, and that's in just a day or two when they're leaving. Liver transplant patients, there is no liver dialysis, so they are going to die at some point from liver failure. And so to have them not only pretty rapidly recover, and then, I tell everybody our goal for the liver transplant, or for any transplant for that matter, is to get the person back to doing what they did, whether it's school, work, retirement, whatever, back to being a human in about 3 months. And it's a really fun experience. When I reflect on it, it's a privilege to be a part of someone's life during that. The vast majority of cases go great. Occasionally we have cases that don't go so great, and those are frustrating and sad, but it's still an experience as a doctor to be a part of someone's life and to have put effort and tried, and it's something that not many people get to experience. And I think it's a privilege.
Well, let me take you back to Hattiesburg.
Okay.
And on the campus of the University of Southern Mississippi. What brought you there in the first place?
Well, I wish I was one of those high school students that looked at a bunch of colleges and had one of the pros and cons. I was never that that fancy. I'm a Mississippi native, although I lived in Texas at the time I graduated high school. Both my parents are alumni of Southern Miss. When I was growing up, I went to some football games. I did basketball camp at Southern Miss. I have aunts and uncles that are alumni from there, so it's very familiar. And it was a great fit for me. It was a great place. I enjoyed Hattiesburg. Can I go back and be a college student again? I'd love that. Met a lot of friends. Still have a lot of friends from that time period. Met my wife, it really was the foundation of what I've become as far as education goes. Lots of fond memories from that point in life, and wouldn't do it differently ever.
Well, talk about some of that education and how it prepared you for what you're doing today.
The thing that I probably took for granted at the time, but as I look back on that, that stands out is the faculty there were very dedicated to educating. And and many of them are still there and they've grown in their roles. But something about their ability to personalize the education, to take time and help direct someone in career paths and give them what I look back on now as really good advice. The other part about my Southern Miss experience, I was in the Honors College, and I thought that was great. It sort of was different from the overall college experience, but you were still embedded in it, and it gave you access to some of your professors that you might not have otherwise had. I spent a summer doing some research at the Medical University of South Carolina, and the group at Southern was just very supportive of that. And when I came back, even helped me finish up that research and write that paper and present it. And that turned out to be my honors thesis. They didn't have to necessarily support me doing things away, but they did. And because I think they were able to personalize what I needed as a student to get to the next level and leverage what I had become interested in to nudge me in that direction. And like I said, I probably didn't appreciate it at the time, but that was really what was going on. Mm-hmm. And, you know, a lot of those leaders are still down there. And I think the core philosophy of chemistry, biochemistry, of the Honors College and of Southern Miss in general is still that way.
So we've looked back. Let's look forward for a second. Okay. You mentioned that there's some risk in what you do. Mm-hmm. And so what are you looking forward to over the next 4 or 5 years in your career?
Well, part of my answer is you never know what tomorrow brings, right? But specifically, like, what are our strategic plans for transplant here? You know, the world's ever-changing. Organ allocation and the way that happens in the United States is changing. And so if we don't change with that, we're going to fail to serve our patients right. Over the last 7.5 years, we've grown from only doing kidney transplants at a low level to doing kidney, liver, pancreas transplants at a above average pace, well above average pace compared to other centers in the U.S. Our volumes are high, so we're doing a good job. There are some frontiers that we still have to improve upon. One is living donor kidney transplant in Mississippi has to improve. You know, we have to grow that as a resource. And the reality is that the number of kidneys available for transplant in the U.S. are way under the number of people waiting on dialysis. The other reality is if you transplant a kidney into someone on dialysis, that person, without a doubt, lives longer. Mm-hmm. It's no questions asked. They live longer. And then healthcare costs that we all talk about. You transplant a kidney in someone on dialysis and convert them to a transplant patient off dialysis. At the 2-year mark, you save money overall in healthcare. So we have to do whatever we can do to transplant more people safely.
Well, I want to thank you so much for taking the time to talk with us
today. It's my pleasure. This has been fun.
Yeah. And I always like to conclude these interviews by saying Southern Miss
to the top.